Hello, and welcome back to my Let's Play video series on Fallen Enchantress. It's been a long time, but I've undergone some hardware changes and gotten a new sort of microphone and everything, so the quality of the video should be a little bit better than what I had before. Now, I don't think I've actually done a Let's Play since the game launched. And this will be the Master's Affliction mod, which is the mod that I created. It's going to be a little bit different than what most people might be used to. But hopefully this will give people an idea of how much fun the mod is. So I guess I'll start out with some explanations of what's different. First of all, I had this weird idea to give all of the Sovereigns weapons and armor so that they can go into the world when you start the game and fight things. Now, not everyone's going to be happy with that sort of ideology, but I think that it's a good idea to do. So here we have Magnar, who's got some leather options here. He's got your full leather suit, and then he starts with the incineration staff. He's a slave lord, which gives him minus 25% labor cost from armor and weapons, which also decreases the wages of his units. Men are fallen in combat are transferred to the nearest city as additional population. He's also got the fleshbound tome, which has been ramped up to be more powerful. Cull of the Weak, I think, gives you 50 mana and HP, so it's a great thing to do on slaves that you think are about to die in battle, or you simply don't need anymore. Deathlash gives you plus 9 attack and initiative, but then kills them at the end of combat. A great sort of boost to give to a slave that you know is pretty much going to be on a suicide run anyways. Scarstone is 2 fire attack, which I think is plus 1 over the vanilla. And then they have the unique improvement, the Emblazoned Tower, which essentially, it's the Wall of Fire, only a slightly weaker version, and you can build it once you've researched, I think it's sorcery. So that's your Magnar faction. Magnar himself is an Archmage, which is plus 25% spell damage and plus 30 spell resistance. That doesn't seem like a very powerful trait, but what this doesn't say, and actually I should probably add it into the provides tag, is he gets Mana Blast, which is, I think it's 100 mana, and your attack will do 10% of your total mana pool in damage to your attacker, or to your target, sorry. Which is fairly powerful later in the game. And that 30 spell resistance is going to be pretty vital for when you're fighting other warlocks and mages, because they get sort of a large amount of spell mastery, and you really can't resist anything they do unless you have some sort of boost to spell resistance. So overall, it's a pretty powerful build for a mage. Also, he has attunement, which is plus 6 mana per turn, so he'll be able to start using fire magic right off the bat. He's got fire apprentice and death apprentice, which gives him a pretty straight shot to soul burn, which is a very powerful fire spell. He's got Quindar blood, which is 75% fire resistance and 25% cold resistance. Actually, that's probably one of the more powerful bloods, because there's a lot of fire damage in the game, and being nearly immune to it has so many uses. He's got plus 2 spell mastery per level, which means that pretty much from level 5 on, no one's going to be resisting much of what he does. Keep in mind that spell mastery works the same way as accuracy. The total number you have is your chance for it to work, and spell resistance is simply subtracts from that chance. So, overall, a powerful guy. I don't know if I'll go through all of them right now, but then you've got an Arch Summoner, which gets Fire, Earth, and Water Apprentice. She also has Life Apprentice, so she's going to have a lot of really good summoning and healing magic. She's got the Enchanters, which gives her these three, these three special staves. Sindarian Staff, 10 attack, 4 defense, 6 dodge, 1 counterattack. Doesn't say when you get it, but I believe you get it from enchantment technology. Late Staff, which is 8 lightning damage at minus 4 initiative. Using the staff gives you plus 30 spell resistance, plus the range attack, which is actually a lightning attack in a radius of 1. So, pretty powerful staff overall. And you'll get that from Magical Forging. And then we have Staff of the Uncoming Storm, which is 10 attack at minus 8 initiative. You have 100 spell resistance, so basically equipping this staff makes you pretty much immune to all magic except that of a warlock who's going to have tons and tons of magic, or someone like Magnar who also has tons and tons of spell mastery. Let's see. And then the difference of this one is it actually hits all enemy units on the field. So if you're fighting sort of like late game siege battles, you're never going to be able to defeat a city unless you have a couple of, I would say, squads of units that are hitting every single unit for damage each turn. Very powerful staff. And you get that from the Enchanters. Adepts, which starts with knowledge and shard harvesting. It's fairly valuable. Allows them to build shrines on mana shards and starts with 300 extra mana. So basically you get the mana boost and a little bit of a boost to your magic abilities. It's nice to have those techs already researched so that you can start utilizing them right away, while also focusing on the civilization techs, which are slightly more valuable to this particular faction. And then of course the scrying pool for plus one essence. Not too much has changed there. Gildan, however, has changed a lot. Most notably, they have a flanged mace, which is a really powerful mace that you'd get when you would expect to get a normal mace, added to their great hammers abilities. Then they have the golem shield, which is pretty heavy, but has some pretty solid bonuses to it when compared to the tower shield. And then of course light plate is a very powerful plate. It's a straight 14 defense at sort of a high weight, but overall it's probably the most efficient armor in the game, because it also, with the Mastersmith, you're going to be paying half for the metal, and it can get pretty powerful pretty quick. He has Might for plus 5 physical attack, Thick Skin for plus 6 defense. He's got Earth Apprentice, Life Apprentice. But honestly, you're going to be using him as a defender pretty much no matter what. And then Ioneer Blood, which is, you know, that 30 spell resistance and plus 1 hit point per level. But you can't really use magic as well. And then he's got the Master Armor trait, which is plus 50% armor. So basically, whatever your armor is, add 50% to it. And you can see while you'll pretty much always want to make him a Path of the Knight or Path of the Commander, depending on your inclination and strategy. Also, he's got plus 40 weight capacity, and in this version of the game, weight capacity is extremely rare, and the penalties are much more severe. So being able to get an extra 40 right as soon as you start the game is extremely valuable. Then we've got Emperor Karavox, who is probably who I play the most. He's the Diplomatic Master, which is Silver Tongue ability, so I can actually steal enemy units if they're strong enough. Not always a good idea to do, but if you see, you know, your enemy come at you with something that's just like, oh, that is ridiculously powerful, you can just instantly change them to your side, which is fairly powerful in its own right. But the big thing is plus 50% value of trades. Now, if you play the game right, and you hoard all of your influence throughout the game, and you never spend it on anything, and then you level every single one of your cities into towns, and get the influence bonuses, you'll have a huge pool of influence, which will increase the value of your trades. Plus this 50%, you can get better than one-to-one deals on resources, and as soon as you open that door, you can start to sort of like broker everybody's resources against them, and make huge amounts of horses and armor and so on, without actually needing a very large empire. It's a very effective sort of strategy. Plus, they have the bronze shield, which is, let's see, 12 defense, 15 air dodge, 5 dodge, so it's a good sort of defensive weapon, and then plus 10 defense with defending, which is standard actually, but the main benefit is their one-handed spears, so you can basically, the best strategy is to get bronze shield and the ice short spear, because you'll have a little bit of magic damage, a very good armor piercing weapon, and you'll have the benefit of a shield to block arrows, which makes you kind of unstoppable on the battlefield. And then throughout the game, you know, you'll get the boar spear, which is pretty much almost as good as the ice short spear, lightning pike, which is only, it's 6 lightning attacks solid now. It used to be per level, but that got out of hand. But it is still 50% resistance to lightning, which can come in handy in certain situations. And then the short pike, which is a standard 14 attack, but it weighs a little bit less, and you can really sort of dominate if you get enough of those guys set up. But that's sort of end game stuff. Also, they start out with 100 influence to start, which means you're the only person on from turn 1 that can get the trading tech, and then merchant cross bazaar, and be able to afford the 100 influence that it costs to build it. So you're pretty much guaranteed that that wonder. However, if you choose to rush over to construction, you can get great mill, depending on which one you prefer. But basically, I think the upshot of that 100 influence is pretty much the cost of any wonder, and you can get that wonder before any non-diplomatic master. Which actually, I've set up the AI to really sort of push hard for those wonders, so don't expect an easy fight for the other ones. Then we have Lady Arane, plus 5 attack, plus 6 crit. She's got Air and Earth Apprentice. Tarth Blood is a... This is actually kind of cool. 50% chance to recall from battle when unit is below 10% HP. So, this is true for anyone with Tarth Blood. You'll basically have some sort of skirmishing tactic where you can charge at full force, and then when you get down to about 10% HP, start defending, and the enemies hit on you will have a chance to teleport that unit back to your capital. So you can sort of hit really hard and not worry about dying, and about half your units will be able to be healed up and ready for the next battle. It's a pretty valuable trait. I see I have some too many provides on tags on this, but I'll clean that up later. It's a plus 50% attack versus beast. Great Beast, Twisted, and Great Twisted. So we tried to add in these Great Beast and Great Twisted tags for boss creatures, but it doesn't. It's actually something that's hard-coded, so we can't change it. It's very disappointing, and I haven't updated the provides tags, I see. But the upshot is Twisted and Beast get plus 50% damage, and, you know, late in the game, that can really change the tides of those sort of late-game random events. There won't be as much of a problem for Lady Arane. Also, she ignores 20% of the victim's defense, so she's got a little boost to armor piercing, which is really good for an archer. Oh yeah, and then of course she's got Masterwork Chainmail, which is different in my version. Basically, I've set it up to have the weight of leather armor with the strength of chainmail. So it's not a heavy armor type like it was in the vanilla game. It's more of the benefits of light armor with the benefits of chainmail without any of the drawbacks of the two. Bows are just slightly better than the normal bows until you get to the ram's horn longbow that replaces the yew longbow, and that actually has 50% armor pierce, which makes it kind of a god bow. Tech rushing to that technology is going to be a pretty solid win for Tarth in most situations. Then we've got Oracle Sarissa, who, let's see, she's got the attunement, so she's, and death, plus Arch Summoner, so she's going to have really strong summoning abilities, but the main thing she has is binding, and binding will increase your, it'll basically every shard you find, you'll get, 3 Burning Race, 3 Crows, 3 Mirror Elementals, etc., but you get more than you would from the vanilla game, because, your whole army is sort of based on those elementals, and the power of those elementals has been increased significantly. Which allows, sort of like a monster with a special ability or spell to be in every army, and kind of give them better odds since they can't use the chain or heavy armors. See, their blood is heal 6 hit points when enemy is killed, minus 1 hit point per level. So if you have a competent army with Wraith Blood, you can combine this with a few other of their trained traits to get extra mana and health from any kills. Not that you'll be getting a lot with those kind of weak units. And then we have Altar, which is sort of the, sort of like what you would think a standard faction is, but since they're the only standard faction, it kind of stands out. They've got a powerful sword, it's got 2 counterattacks on it. Fending Blade has 2 counterattacks, but in addition to that, in unit design, there's a trait called Weapon Mastery that gives them an additional counterattack, so really they can get 3 counterattacks, which is pretty strong. Of course, Lord Relius has +1 counterattack, Might and Cunning for the crit and damage abilities. Air Apprentice, so he can basically sort of work himself up to an Air Mage if you get a good magic start. And then Altarian Blood is +50% experience. Which is huge. I mean, pretty much the bread and butter of this faction is doing quests, and this will give you so much more experience from doing quests, it gets kind of ridiculous. And if you want to bring train units too, like even early game train units with just staves are going to be ridiculously strong meat shields later in the game, because they just keep on leveling where other units sort of taper off, they're going to keep on moving up. The other benefit of this guys, he's got the Adventurer, which gives starts at 2nd level, so he's going to have his Path of the Whatever as soon as the game starts. He's got +2 moves, so he's going to be able to move in and out of monsters really well from turn 1. And if you give him a horse, he's going to have 6 moves. So this gets sort of like the best Adventurer, simply because he can move farther, faster, and safer than any other unit. But it also sort of lends him to sort of solitary movement, which means you won't be able to attack a lot of stuff, but just the ability to explore that much, you can get maybe 6 or 7 extra techs in the early game if you explore well enough and find enough research bonuses. So that's the basic way I've set up the factions. There's sort of probably more nuances that I'm explaining. But that is the sort of upshot. So I don't know how to use this quite as well as I would like. I guess Control-Alt-Escape works fine. I'm going to pause real quick to make sure I have this. Alright, so I'm back again. Yeah, I made some changes to the shields, but I wasn't sure that they had taken effect in this version. Turns out they had, so there was actually not the crisis that I perceived. So which faction should I play? I think I'm going to go with Kraxis, just because I know them so well, and I'm not sure that everyone plays them the same way I do. You know what? Sorry, I have to pause again. I do this sort of rusty at this, but, Alright, back again. Sorry, I realized that I still am having trouble setting the recruitment values for heroes. And if you choose Kraxis, you're sort of missing out on a huge part of your ability, which is Betrayers. And that's, it would be Altar, actually. But it reminded me when I was choosing these guys. Altar gets free hero recruits, but since every recruit pretty much costs 10 Gildar now, that became kind of meaningless. So I upped the cost, and hopefully it's not too much, but probably just enough to matter a little bit more. So I decided, yeah, Krax is going to be the one for me. I'll do my standard map, which is called Pre-Road. Wildland Frequency actually doesn't apply to a custom map. Champion Frequency. Do moderate. Dense is actually extremely dense now. Quest Frequency. Plenty is fine. Difficulty. I suppose harder will be alright. Monster frequency, unmoderate. Now you can change this up to terrifying or go down to some. I suggest most people start out with some just to get the hang of the way the layers work. Unmoderate is much more difficult than the average game. Pacing, normal. If you're starting out, you should play as fast so that you stand a better chance against the monsters in the world. Magic strength, moderate is actually very few shards in the game. And the upshot is basically shards at level 3 shards, if you upgraded them, have some pretty massive effects for your whole civilization. So you don't want to have too many because it'll make the bonuses too powerful and sort of shift the game towards too much magic. However, for the sake of it, I'm going to turn it up to dense. You know what? Actually, this map has plenty of shards on its own, so that won't be really necessary. Resource frequency, I suggest you play on dense if you're just starting out, because honestly, it'll help out the AI until you build them better units. Random event frequency, I'm going to set that to more often will be fine. There's some pretty nasty random events in this version. But I haven't released them to the public yet because they aren't tested, so that's kind of what I'm doing here. AI difficulty. Chuck Norris is really challenging, but it doesn't give any extra HP to the enemy. Expert, ridiculous, and insane increase enemy HP by 10% cumulatively. I don't know, I usually stick to harder because I think it's plenty challenging as far as the AI factions go. Let's see, so that would be 20% bonus to economy. Yeah, I don't want to give them too much power. Alright, you know what I'll do? I'll customize opponents. And who would be a natural enemy for me? Perhaps Magnar will get Chuck Norris on one side, and Lord Relius will get Chuck Norris on the other. Should be interesting. That way I'll have a few sort of standout AIs to deal with, but I won't get overwhelmed, hopefully. I'm really excited. I haven't done much playing recently because I've only been on cloth map mode for the past month. This will be my first
time.
Men
of the West call you a traitor. They say you have betrayed the principles of mankind. Nobility, honor, fairness. They look down upon you with contempt and say they will never trust the Kraxis again. They are fools. History shows it was the Amarian who abandoned the Kraxis, who left your armies to stand alone in the east. Your grandfather and father, your friends and neighbors died fighting for the race of man. You are determined not to share their fate. You will forge a new Kraxis, one that stands apart from all others, men and fallen alike. A civilization destined to be spoken of in the same breath as the kingdoms of Halas and Malaya, of Al-Asheroth, and fabled Antheris.
I really like that intro for Karavox. I think they have one of the most interesting stories. However, there's a little bit of graphical glitching, which I've never noticed before. I wonder what that's about. It's gone now. Okay, so here's my start. As you can see, this pre-made map has a pretty generous helping to your first city, with basically the idea that the more powerful I can make this city, the less people will whine to me about how difficult the game is. So here we go, a 5-4. Krax leans heavily towards one large fortress and several towns supporting it. So I'll make this my fortress here. Settle. I love this graphic. Ah, yes. Okay, so there's my first town here. Oh, one thing that I'll be pointing out throughout the game is I've started my project on increasing the sort of epicness of tiles, the tile art design. So I'm going to be turning sort of this that looks like maybe 10 people could live here or something like that, and I'm going to be changing that to make it look like 100 people could live here, because that's about what it should look like. So basically I'll just be changing the scale of things. Alright, so here we start. Let's see what we have over here. Resolve, a water mage. Weak. See, I'm reluctant to spend one Gildar per turn on someone like this. She's just not going to add much to the team, you know? Yeah, and I don't even have any essence for the city, so that makes her less valuable. Always start out with a logging camp. Oh, that was loud. It's too loud. Okay, so logging camp, and then of course Tower of Dominion, which in this version is plus one growth per season. That. Now we'll check research. I kind of want Rush By right away because I've got so much extra Gildar. Yeah, I'm going to do Civics first. See, I have 1250 Gildar. You gotta spend that money. So, here is... Let's see if I can get... This is about the size of the map. Here, and I'm right about there. Okay, so I'm guessing that this would be the direction to go. Ah, yes, I can build the town up here. It's gonna be a pretty good town. So let's take a look at monsters. We got four Ophidians here, but they've got zero moves, so I don't need to worry about them right away. Here we have Ania. She can be recruited. She's level 3. So what kind of blood is that? Irksan blood. That's perfect for my faction. Alright, I'll have to get over to her. So, you know, it's kind of a waste of resources to spend 9 turns not building units. But I'm gonna go for a Civ Turtle strategy. A Civics Turtle strategy, if you will. For this first phase. Which means I'll have kind of a weak army. And I'm gonna have trouble clearing out some of these spawns. The intention for the game is as soon as you start, you build your logging camp. And then the choice is Tower of Dominion or start trading units. But I don't want to research the requisite technology for Krax units quite yet. get my rush by abilities up first. Okay, so here we go. Yeah, 186 Gildar for this unit. That's pretty good for a level 3, I think. Okay, so let's check out her equipment. Wow. Only 26% encumbrance. Okay. Why is her encumbrance 30? This is 20. Oh, she's got Path of the Warrior. Okay, that's fine. Let's go there. And there. Legend of Tondas. Not gonna let her use it though. Okay, so now I have to decide if I want to go the magic route and turn these three magical abilities into a pretty decent summoner, or do I want to go the warrior route and have a stronger general. I think that just based on what my starting area is, I'm going to be better off with Path of the Warrior. So that's that. Now, Path of the Warrior gives you plus one attack per level. I guess it'll say here. Yeah, plus 5 hit points per level, plus 1 attack per level, and plus 10 weight capacity. So already his initiative is boosted. It's minus 3 initiative for medium and minus 6 for heavy. And he went from heavy to medium. I actually should get him back to the city now, since I have another scout. Okay, so up here, there's some stalkers, which are going to be a good early kill. And then we've got trolls. Alright, oh, and don't forget those rock spiderlings. What's the armor on a spiderling? 10. Alright, I can take them out soon. Those units can move. Which means I don't want to go that way. You might notice that some of these early game lairs are actually able to move, which is kind of rare in this version of the game. Most lair bosses only have zero moves on the strategic map, so that they're sort of stuck there to defend their lairs. But these sort of early game ones are not as tough. And they're able to move around a bit. But once they upgrade, they'll upgrade with a lair boss that won't be able to move. So the trick is to kill them early on. Okay, so we get growth at plus 3 per turn. 16. So, yeah, 6 turns to my level up for the city. I'm gonna go fortress here. And I've got 2 turns on that. There's no real reason to go into that forest. I think I'll explore on the other side of this river. Pretty much know what you're gonna find on the other side of that forest, and that is lots of ogres. Pretty much any expansion base will have ogres or some other such tough guy on it. Alright, Warfare. I'll take training and then leatherworking. Oh, here we go. Nice little grain-based town over here, perhaps. Uh-oh. Bandits. Tough bandits. See, look, they've got two guardians. It's pretty extreme. What's the distance there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 6. Yeah, it's about right for a bandit lair. What have we here? Ooh, into Steel Hand. Let's check him out. He's got road building and path to governor, plus obsession. It's gonna be worth taking two injuries to get this guy. Okay, I have to do it next turn. Also, look at this, a 5-2-1. It's perfect for a town. Alright. I wonder if there's a forest nearby. One next to a river. That's even better. Oh wow. So he'll go there. And then they'll move there. I can move there and there. So I should be fine. Make it a little bit easier to get over here. Oops. Market always tries to build too early. Take the metal, and then grow. I don't actually want the pier quite yet, but I'll keep it in my queue to get this little over-the-river exploit here. And now my growth is at 4. Which means this is going to be one powerful town. I'm going to put the Great Mill in here, too. Just need to get these quick leatherworking tech done. Alright, so fortress. Oh, and I've got the prestigious location. It's going to give me a jump on my second wonder. See, in this version of the game, wonders are all about gaining influence. Kraxis is the best faction for getting lots of it. Prestigious location. I'll add it to the queue, but I think it's going to take too long. Stupid pier. I moved it to the back of the queue, but it didn't work. Oh well, I'll just build it. Can't be too bad for me. Then my scouts. Oh, I need to find a place with essence. I suppose this will work, but it's not going to be ideal. That 5-2-2 is almost better. I guess I'll just send them on. fire is coming out. So I guess I'll recruit her now. It's only 30 Gildar. Very cheap. Oh, she's encumbered. That's funny. Need to get rid of some of that weight. Oh, that's why she's carrying a war staff. Jeez. I'd rather her be unarmed. Trade that off to someone else. Steel Hand is using a normal spear. He's at 80%. Or no, she... he's at 80%. Okay, that's fine. Long run, this monument will be more valuable than an orchard. Oh, and then I need to queue up my other stuff. See, now I'm at the interesting point where I question, do I want to go Lumberyard for the extra 8 production per turn? Or do I want to take Mining, which is 3 production per turn, which would be 12 production per turn. But it's twice the cost. But actually, it also gives me smelter, so I'm gonna need it. Oh, and knowledge is included in that cost. Okay, so this one's working a little bit better. It's not a bear that was getting loose, it's a spider on top of a bear. That's not as bad for some reason. But I will retreat anyways. I'm not quite ready to start pumping out units. I want to get maximum benefit of my fortress first. Oh, look at that, the Ophidians are out and about. Thought I set them not to do that. I just realized that this End of Steel Hand can boost my growth by an additional 2. This is gonna be a powerful turtle here. See, look at that. Plus 6 growth. That's huge. Very much enjoy the advanced graphics that I'm now able to use. And the very fast turn times. Water Disciple. Oh, what should I choose here? I do like Air Disciple because then I can go up to Cloud Walk, which is very powerful. And then there's Water Disciple for Gentle Rain, though. Actually, I don't think I have the other prereqs for Gentle Rain. Could take Charismatic for an additional +1 growth. overall, Earth Disciple is going to be better for Path of the Defender, which is the way that he's going. Sorry, I'm used to very long turn times here. And these ones are going much too quickly. A ton of magic. I'm gonna make her a governor. She's not gonna be worth much else. So I've got three governors now. Well, that's pretty rare, actually. And only one warrior. Actually, technically two warriors, because Kraxis or Karabox has dual class. So there's the forge, then we got barracks, and then study. So this is the point where I start to say that the rush mine is a good idea. Get rid of some of this sort of extra stuff here. Train. So this is my most basic Kraxis unit that I'll usually build. Let me double check and make sure there's nothing else I need first. Nope, I'm good. So this is a leather, short spear, and wood shield. Very powerful unit. So yeah, three is going to be max for each here, so that'll be... Alright, so I've got mining, that's going to boost production. Next I want agriculture, and then construction. This is the basic way that I play Kraxis. I just sort of rush by through all the buildings in my fortress and make sure I'm constantly building troops. It's pretty easy once you've got a strong army to expand your economy. So I gotta make sure that I'm just really focusing on that aspect. So we'll take that unit, or this army, for a spin. But there's no reason to send them out unless I'm going to be colonizing something. I think I just saw some bears up there. Bears are a pretty good counter to spear and shield. 175, 175, which means I don't need my governor here any longer. Yep, there's the bears. I'll be honest with you, that is not good. I've waited too long. And actually, everything's already upgraded because, yeah, it's already turned 35. Oh, it should be more accurate. Things aren't necessarily upgrading yet, but the possible spawns are starting to crop up, the things that they will spawn. Turn 70 is the first time that you'll really see anything upgrade layer-wise, for the most part. I'm thinking I might need to switch over to the two logistics techs. Oh, there's a 422. I should take that. So I've kited that bear out of my way. Oh no, stalkers. That's not good. Anyways, I should be able to get to that over there fast enough. Oh, look. Ophidian army. Good stuff over here. It's a cave bear down here already. Oh, I see. I'm far enough away from my start over there that it'll spawn those more difficult challenges. Whoops. I meant to be building guards over here. In fact, I think I might want an advanced guard to soften up those bears. Some wildings up there. Oh, a fire shard. Could be good. See if I can't attract these bears to me. Might be able to get them to double back. Bear's attack, 21. That's pretty good. I'm gonna need a larger army. Whoa there. That's pretty cool looking. Just a horde of fire snakes. Whoops. I can't believe I left those pioneers over there that whole time. Now that area is kind of full. Looks like they've trapped me. There's no tile I can move to without being adjacent to a monster. Well, I'd rather be attacked by rock spiders. What's their attack? 8 times 4. Health 180. My attack is 9 times 3. Health 48. Don't have any traits, it's just straight damage. And 10 defense. Alright, well, I guess I could rush by. Make the army I was going to. Do some shopping here. So I hope this works out. That's not good. Won't be able to kill these Ophidians yet until I get some blunt. Never really built too many blunt units for Kraxis before. Oh, whoops. Not sure I want gloves. I think I'm gonna stick with staff. Maybe Bushido and I suppose frontline couldn't hurt either. All right. So we'll call this, oh, and those are just, one season. So... I'd like to take out that spider as well. This spider can turn into a very dangerous lair if I don't kill it. as I suspected, they're sort of baiting me on. Alright. Actually, I'm glad I didn't build there. This 3-4 right here is a much better choice. I think I'm just gonna have to break down and kill that bear. That was more bloody than the version that I usually play. Surprising. See, now these shrills in my version, they all have pretty much lightning attack for their main attack, so nothing that my armor is doing is helping me at all. It's going to be very problematic if they ever get into large groups. Alright, but I did kill them, so now I can earn my fleeing that I'm doing there. Oh boy, I didn't see those Ophidians. They blend in so well. I'm gonna sacrifice the spearmen. Hopefully that works. Oops, I need 3 of those. Well, really, just 4 of them. Pull that stuff out. Yeah. See, I'm gonna use those to hit these rock spiderlings and those guys there. Just sort of a throwaway unit to counter the monster. Darn, I was hoping they would attack the weaker army. This is not gonna go well. What traits do I have here? Oh yeah, these are frontliners, so that's good at least. See, they've got 57 attack with just leather armor for their first couple of turns. But they do 0 damage. So this is why you need ice spears so quickly, because ice spears would be doing 2-4 damage here. Or it'd actually be 1-4 damage, technically. Yeah, you can't even touch the Infinities unless you bring the right counter. Twisted Ankle, minus one initiative. Eh, not the end of the world. But I will take him away. So Ophidian moves there. I should have moved there. Cool. Hopefully those Ophis have had their fill. Guess not. So Ophidian moves there. One more turn for my forest guard. Yes. Stands unmoving outside her small home. It isn't until you get closer that you realize she is standing at a crude grave. She doesn't say anything and you are anything at your approach, and for a few long minutes after. That's sort of an awkward sentence. Then she spits on the grave and turns towards you. What have you come to take? I have nothing left, she demands. I am sorry for your loss, you say. Totally not in my character. Her eyes go vacant again, then she snaps back. When she notices you eyeing the grave, she says, I didn't know this one. Three men, creatures, came to my house and attacked my husband, Neville. He was a strong man once, able to take branches off an oak with one swing of his axe. But that was years ago. She grows quiet before continuing. They came for him, not for the last few pieces of gold we keep in the butt. In the butter jar, not for our chickens or newling pigs. They killed him right here, and when they did, one of the three fell down and died right beside him, even though he hadn't been struck. The two other carried Neville's body away but left the dead one. I don't understand. So my choice or my reward is a battle axe. I can avenge your husband. I'm gonna go ahead and avenge the husband. I want to see where this goes. See, now I finally have a little bit of an advantage on these Ophidians. If I can get these guys healed up, I will actually attack. But at the very least, I should be able to take out those rock spiders. See how quickly they're growing in number? That's what happens when you turtle. You lose advantage on everything around you. Let's see how this plays out. These are front lines, so they need to move forward right away. So you're way better off getting the defense shield. Because they'll take zero damage for this first three rounds, which means that you have a pretty clear advantage. And then I'll do 2 to 4 damage. What is the defense on a rock spiderling? Oh, okay, it's 5 defense against blunt. So I really should have brought spearmen against these, but that's not why I focused this army. See, I was assuming I would have 3 to 6 damage, which would make this battle a little more even. So I didn't quite kill one spiderling. I expected to do a little bit better than that. I thought I'd kill at least two. But I didn't think I'd have any defense. And their initiative's higher than I thought. Alright, so there's a little lesson learned. I'm gonna retreat. Oh, another thing to look at. I think I've been wasting taxes here. Yeah, there we go. See, I can set my taxes to high and recoup some of that money. Alright, so I've got smelter, the expansion, I'll take merchant next. Oh, and then I have garden to do. Alright, so not the best playthrough of Master's Affliction so far, but you get an idea of what happens when you turtle, at least a cautionary tale, if you will. I think I'm going to make a break here and come back to it a little bit later, but you get the overall idea, I think. And so now that I've sort of resigned myself to having one city like this, I'm going to raise the tax rate and possibly do a little more rush buying. Once I have construction finished, I'll want to rush buy my great mill. So hopefully that works out, but we'll see in the next video. Thanks for watching.